Hello, thank you for attending this talk. So I'll start by asking a question. So as evident, which vertical line is shorter that you see? Like, do you have any preferences, left, right?
The same, no?
Okay, yeah. The room is divided.
We all think it's smart, but
yeah, very interesting. I'll show you. I've asked this question to other people as well, and the statistical data was very interesting. And then I thought, okay, let me ask someone who probably is more smarter, because it was trained on more data, which is ChatGPT. Let's see. Okay. Well, I asked ChatGPT, hey, tell me, what is it, what do you think? And ChatGPT was able to identify. So few of our listeners here said that both the lines are same. Actually, both the lines are the same. So this is what is called Mueller-Lyer optical illusion. So just because of the way the arrows are structured, it seems that one line is taller or shorter than the other. Okay, I give ChatGPT plus one. Great, you have been trained on good data. Now let me test, or I try to test, the logical skill set of ChatGPT, which we humans, as a child, we have been trained by default on. So if we have a bag of laundry and we add to it another bag of laundry, what do we get? So it's pretty easy, like we'll get one bag of laundry, right? Or a pile of book to add to it, what do we get? One pile of book. Let me see what ChatGPT says to this. ChatGPT says, and that's ChatGPT 4.0. It says that, there will be two bags of laundry. Surprise, surprise. How did that happen? I give a benefit of doubt to ChatGPT. Okay, maybe it got confused. Let's be more kind to it. Let me try to ask a more mathematical question. Let's say if you have a half glass of water, and if you add another half glass of water, what do we get? The answer was right, one glass of water. That made me infer that the mathematical logic on which the data, the ChatGPT was trained on, did help it to get to this answer. Whereas the logical side of things is quite kind of, it has room to improve. Well, hello all, I am Sagar Saxena. I have 15 years of working experience, out of which 5 years in mainframes, and 7 years I've been in AI, and I'm a senior machine learning engineer working in Genesis, Ireland at the moment, and I'm also an AI mentor and with students all over the world. So let's clean up some air. Recently, the likes of ChatGPT, Gemini, Anthropic Claude has been gaining a lot of light. I would like to just make it, like before go to the next part of it, I would like to make a standard and define what are these. So AI, we have been interested in AI since the onset of 1950s when the paper was published by Alan Turing about the computational intelligence. So AI is something that deals with data and robotics. So combining both is AI. Machine learning is a subset of it that deals with data and a lot of prediction. That's probabilistic in nature. Going further down, there comes the part where we all have been recently exploring a lot, which are neural networks. How, you may ask, how do we get the name from? That's human brain. We have been basically interested in understanding how the human brain works, and we are still trying to emulate some of its processing power, which is the origin of deep learning. We have a lot of data. We train something called a neural network, and we get some probabilistic predictions on top of it. Now comes generative AI, or Gen AI, you may all call it. This is where the likes of large language models, or something of large foundation models, comes in. So these have been recently gaining a lot of popularity because of two precise things. What are those? The amount of data that it was trained on, and the amount of text or images per se it can generate, and that's all because of the progress of computational power. Let's take a sneak peek into human brain. Why? Because that's been the source of interest, and we have been trying to emulate it for long. I won't go into the neuroscience 101 because that would take a lot of time. That's beyond the scope of it. But if you guys are interested, please have a look at Andrew Huberman, and I think he is a Stanford professor. He does a great job in that. So human brain structurally has three major parts. cerebrum, cerebellum, and you have the brainstem. So now inside the cerebrum, that's the cervical, that's the cortex, the neocortex, that's divided into different lobes, and that's where we have different parts that functions on the memory, long-term memory, short-term memory, the languages and the vision and other functions that we do. I'll come to this relation later on in my talk, just to give you a high-level overview. So I think as the cerebrum or the neocortex to be like an orchestrator, and it's a protector under which there are some specialization that are basically honed on certain aspects, or we are training them from the child, from our childhood days. And there are cranial nerves that carry the signals and stuff. Proceeding on, an interesting question is, everyone asks, like, oh, we have to learn. But no one defines what is learning. So let's try to debug that. Well, how do we learn, for example? So let's say there are three major classifications of learning. One is we learn by reading. So that's, let's say, one-dimensional thing. We read one word at a time. And the next is actively doing things. So we interact with the environment, we gain the experience, we have emotions attached to it. It's a reward penalty mechanism that is actively doing. The third is most interesting one, bulk mode, which I think at the moment, unfortunately, we have not mastered that. So we'll need at least multiple sections of input, let's say eyes, and we are reading 10 books at the same time. Well, it would be interesting to have, isn't it? We can learn things faster. So for the reading and the bulk reading, I want to club them into one. So why? Because they are all basically, let's say, focused on textual data. It can be text, it can be numbers or something like that. Reading, as I defined, it's a one-dimensional mode of learning where we are reading one text at a time, if in a book or something. And bulk load, as I defined. But learning by actions, that's very interesting because when we are interacting with the environment, we are not living in an isolated environment, unless it was COVID or something, but let's say it's in the past. But when we are interacting with the environment, we are getting some feedback, and that's creating experience. So that's how I define learning. It's creating neural pathways in our brain when we are interacting with the environment, and by repetition, by attaching some emotion, those neural pathways persist, and we keep the knowledge up. Proceeding on, why do we not have this capability yet? Before LLMs, if someone is an avid reader, I love reading books, I want to gather as much as knowledge as possible. It was not possible because in the human time span, the amount of data that's being generated, it's very difficult to consume everything because of accessibility and also processing power. That's where LLMs come to the rescue, which are large language models. They are trained on something called a transformer architecture, which was published by Google in 2017 in a paper called Attention is All You Need. They are again neural-based architectures, so you feed in a lot of data, and they try to find correlations and patterns in the data, and they give you some prediction, or let's say generate some text or image at the moment. And these are a few of the ones, which is ChatGPT by OpenAI, Claude by Anthropic, let's say, Gemini by Google, and by X Grok, which is trained on the X data, which was previously known as Twitter. Learning by actions is another forte of AI, which is reinforcement learning. So I'll be touching briefly about it at the end. Now, let's take a step forward, and that's about language, that's about reading. We are also very visual. We understand, we look at images, those are two-dimensional data, and we gather patterns from that. Actually, we are sending the signals from the eyes, and in the brain, all the processing happens. So that's for that. We also develop large vision models. Surprise, surprise. How do they train? So we feed in a lot of image data, and they are, after a lot of processing and engineering, these, again, they are new transformer-based neural architectures. They are trained on these images, and that's what now the next thing they generate is images. So large language models, plus large vision models, are called something called large multimodal models, and all the latest versions of these models have these capability. Moving on, the recent addition to it is large world models. We also live in a world which is 3D. There are physics laws attached to it, and that's where world models comes in. So these models are trained on laws of physics, and it understands the environment around. And for example, in the recent paper, it was published where it was trained on 1 hour long of a YouTube video, and very specific questions were asked, and only large world models was able to respond to those questions. It's an interesting specialization, I would say. We have text specialization, we have vision specialization, and now we have the physics specialization. So all these advancements have been possible because of NVIDIA, of course, the hardware, the compute, and the processing it provides. Nevertheless, the data storage and the Google, the clouds have also been helpful for all this processing and storing the data, be it AWS cloud, Google, or Azure. And the most importantly, on top of it, we have the neural architectures. Thankful for the attention mechanism and the transformers that led to this development. This is a Tableau structure. I've tried to compare the terminologies of machine learning with the humans. So for example, when we say a model is training on data, that's similar to when we as humans learn. What we try to fine tune a model to be good performing on a certain domain or a certain task. That's for us is trying to read our something very specific and trying to perform well in that particular domain, extending our knowledge. For example, generalizing on unseen data, so that we want the model to be performing well on unseen data. So that is similar to us being able to apply our experience and knowledge. Similarly, hallucinations. LLMs have been hallucinating. They're producing text which is not true. And it's similar to us sometimes making stories under performance pressure. Last but not the least is prompt engineering. So it's similar to having the knowing what to ask, and that's famous quote of Socrates. Knowing what to ask gives us the capability to answer the right questions. And these are the latest advancements in reinforcement learning, where we feed in all these into a humanoid structure. I'm pretty much interested in unit 3 G1 humanoid. It's $16,000, and it does great job in talking to a human and doing day-to-day work. These are the potential breakthroughs that I think are already ongoing or would be, in the future, they would be making a big mark. So dealing with data, bias detection and handling as part of AI ethics, and explaining these models are very crucial. And having the emotional intelligence fed into the model and the model trained on that would be great. Last but not the least, the AI agents, who, if they are able to plan, that would be great. I think that's something that would be developed soon. And if they're able to do that, the interesting question would be, would these AI agents be considered under GDP? Because we can have infinite AI agents and infinite population, and how do we calculate the GDP then? I'll conclude by saying AI is a powerful transformative technology. The sooner we embrace it and contribute to it, the better it would be. Thank you so much.